As we all know, NASCAR and big money are a necessary combination needed to secure and maintain the well-being of NASCAR itself. That is exactly why you see guys like Paul Menard get top-tier rides, even if they don't have the success to back it up. By-ride endeavors, much like the art of pay drivers, are also a necessary evil in this case. Now I'm sure you guys are asking, what is ride buying, you say? Typically, what you'll see is a top-tier driver or team with an immense amount of money fail to make the race, whether it's on speed or an issue or wreck during the weekend. And obviously you have guys like Rick Hendrick, Roger Penske that are much richer than, say, the JTG Dohertys and the Go Fast Racings of the sport. Thus, those big owners or ones with sponsorship tend to shop the garage and hope to buy out a smaller team for that ensuing race. The pursuing team gets to have their sponsor and driver in the race, and they likely get to keep up the driver's points that they have maintained. On the flip side, the smaller teams usually get a staggering amount of cash that the owners at the top simply can't say no to. And in some cases, the team could get the beneficiary of a higher level driver racing their equipment. Therefore, they could learn a trick of the trade to get their cars ever so faster in a tight NASCAR garage that you see today. This has been a common practice in NASCAR's 7-decade history, and today I'm going to look at the most intriguing buy-a-ride moments in league history. Believe it or not, even the Almighty King once had to shop amongst his peasants just to get into the race. Richard Petty's famous number 43 was involved in a pretty violent practice crash prior to the 1986 Coca-Cola 600. So much so, Petty suffered a concussion and a bruised leg from the incident. What wasn't bruised was Petty's desire to keep his consecutive streak of 433 races alive and well. Yet, after qualifying 15th the Wednesday prior, Dale Inman was forced to withdraw the 43 from the race. That meant sponsor STP would have to scout the garage to get the King entered in the event paying well over $700,000. After hunting the garage, a handshake agreement would be reached for Petty to race the number 6 owned and raced by New Jersey native DK Ulrich. And for many Richard Petty fans, this would definitely be the weirdest race they've ever seen their driver compete in. The Petty blue and Dayglow orange were gone, and instead it was a white and neon green number 6 with the STP logo on the hood. And also, unlike the competitive nature, pretty much this would be his start just for the sake of getting on track and keeping the streak alive. The King himself even stated he might be too sore from the crash to compete all 600 miles, with Ulrich ultimately on standby if something happened. Ultimately, the neon green number 6 Chevrolet DNF'd on lap 123 by virtue of engine issues. But most importantly, Petty's streak continued, and this is one of the most intriguing NASCAR trivia questions out there. Before Kmart became the Old Yeller of the retail scene, their NASCAR sponsorship was also at a dying stage as well. Darrell Waltrip, well past his prime, took on one last season before hanging up the helmet. Most races, a top 30 finish was just as satisfying as actually winning the damn race itself. And unfortunately for the elder Waltrip, things took a further turn for the worst as DW, winner of 5 Coca-Cola 600s, failed to time in with his number 66 Ford Taurus. This marked as a second DNQ in 2 races. On the flip side of the coin, slotting into the 43 car field is a familiar backmarker name today in Carl Long. The 32-year-old qualified for his first NASCAR Cup Series race by timing in 35th on the speed chart. Definitely for a younger driver, finally making a NASCAR Cup race. Nonetheless, the biggest race of the year is definitely something special. Yet the engine inside his Ford Taurus wasn't fit for an endurance test of 600 miles. Therefore, the North Carolina resident did an honorable thing by stepping out of his number 85 car and letting Darrell Waltrip start his final Coca-Cola 600. With how grateful he was, Darrell Waltrip had strong appraisal for Long's actions, calling him a new friend and a gracious act for a young driver. So in the end, Jaws was able to race the baby blue and yellow big Kmart Ford in his final 600-mile endurance run. As for the result, it was a pretty typical outing for the Kmart car. Meanwhile, after 5 more DNQs on the year, Carl Long would finally make his first NASCAR Cup Series start, finishing 41st at the Fall Dover race. So at the end of the day, it was a pretty even trade-off as Darrell Waltrip got to start his final 600 and Carl Long and the 85 team were a little bit better off and had much more dignity going forward. Much like brother Darrell, Michael Waltrip also had problems qualifying as his career went from garbage top 30 rides to broadcasting for NASCAR on Fox. 2006 was a complete train wreck, driving for the Doug Bowell owned and fielded number 55. The entry continually sank to the point of needing to qualify on time to make the race. The main cure to get out of this hole was to, of course, keep qualifying for races and avoid going home at any point during the season. That fate wouldn't be dodged during the 2006 Coca-Cola 600. Slotting the 47th fastest time, the younger Waltrip failed to qualify for the race. For Waltrip, this would be the first such occurrence since 1998. Meanwhile, on the flip side of the coin, Derek Cope put the McGlynn Motorsports number 74 into the big show. He was prepared to make just his fourth start of the season after having a DNQ rate of over 75%. That is, until Napa Auto Parts put forth an offer the small team which Reynard Glynn owned just couldn't refuse. In the process, Michael Waltrip got the seat with the 74 car being renumbered to the 55. Now, despite the number change, the owner points accumulated would still go to the 74. In that case, any finish Michael Waltrip had wouldn't be able to help the Waltrip Jasper Dodge as it tried to get back into the top 35. As for Waltrip's performance in the race, the entry only lasted a good 116 laps before brake issues caused Mikey to head to the garage. And as for the aftermath, it wasn't a good ending for both sides, as Michael Waltrip and Jasper Racing would fail to qualify for more races before separating, and McGlynn Motorsports would cease operations in July 2007. But at the end of the day, millions got to further see the embarrassments of the Napa car in the late 2000s. Now let's go to a pretty chaotic story, as qualifying for the 2015 Folds of Honor Quickstrip 500 was a cataclysm to behold. 13 cars did not post a qualifying lap, including 4 NASCAR Cup Series champions. Tony Stewart called it a total waste of a day at the track after devoting the day strictly to qualifying and then never making a lap on track. With Stewart, Jeff Gordon, Jimmy Johnson, Matt Kenseth, and Jeff Burton relying on provisionals, some solid race teams were sent packing and going home. The H Scott number 46, driven by Michael Annette, was one of those heading back to North Carolina. The team didn't have an owner point safety net after expanding to a second entry during the offseason. Nonetheless, as we all know, the Iowan carried heavy financial backing from gas station chain Pilot Flying J. After shopping the NASCAR Cup garage, the number 33 Chevrolet of Brian Scott was purchased to continue Annette's full-time campaign. And I know what you're thinking, how is Brian Scott of all people a victim of ride buying? After all, Shore Lodge was the only reason Scott ever scrapped together a competitive career to begin with. Now, compared to his other Shore Lodge races that season, his Circle Sport number 33 was unsponsored for that race. Brian Scott was merely driving that car to keep the momentum and because of the convenience that he was entered in the Xfinity race for RCR. All in all, this would be a good business day for Joe Falk as he made a profit with the Pilot red and yellow replacing the blank hood space. And as for Michael Annette in this race, it was more of the mediocrity and subpar results you come to expect. A 29th place finish 6 laps off of Jimmy Johnson's winning pace. But considering he hadn't worked with Todd Parrott and had to race for a completely different team, getting a top 30 is pretty solid compared to other instances. So in that case, Pilot got to showcase their brand to the Atlanta fanbase, and Michael Annette got to continue his quest for the Drivers' Championship, even though it wasn't very successful. But in some instances, big money may not always be the driving force. This rare case happened to Jesse Owuji prior to the 2019 Truck Series playoff race at Las Vegas. The U.S. Navy Reserve secured sponsorship from Redlist and was set to race for the Rayone brothers. Those hopes unfortunately were dashed during time trials. Owuji's plain white Silverado plowed into the pit wall, completely destroying the nose of the 34 truck. Despite the massive hit, fortunately, Owuji was able to walk away unscathed. The truck, however, was found to go to the North Carolina junkyard Monday morning. In this case, typically you know the standard drill. The crewmen unload the backup, get it through inspection, and roll the truck out to the starting grid with no practice time outside of past races with the chassis. But due to the smaller budget, smaller operation of the Rayom team, they didn't have a prepped backup to enter for that race. Thus, enter Justin Johnson and the Kart Idaho Racing Team. Johnson, the hometown hero, was vying to make his first truck start since 2011. Driving the 08 Sigma Toyota, he couldn't time his way into the field and would be one of the trucks heading home. That all changed when Rayom approached them and Justin Johnson would be entered in that night's race. Believe it or not, the only thing they did to the truck was replace the 08 with the 34. Even though the truck was a Toyota and obviously the Rayom team drove Chevrolet Silverados. At that point, it was two small teams trying to get all they could get, and that was the best possible scenario for both parties. So going towards the 34 team's owner's points, Justin Johnson drove the number 34 Sigma Toyota to a 23rd place finish. And considering this was his first start since 2011, he actually did pretty good. This was obviously the race of chaos for the truck series, and he ended up beating a couple Thor Sport trucks and other playoff drivers. And then just recently, Watermelon King Ross Chastain has been at the forefront of the buy-a-ride scene quite a bit during his competitive career. Obviously, you have last February for the NASCAR Racing Experience 300. Ross Chastain's number 10 Nutrien Ag Camaro experienced brake issues during his qualifying lap. This was a part of a disastrous time trial session for Colleague Racing. With very minimal owner's points, the 10 and 16 entries DNQ'd and were exiled to the team transporters. For AJ Allmendinger, this kinda sucked. You're not gonna be able to race Daytona and win at the World Center of Racing. But for the Watermelon King Ross Chastain, this smashed a strong start to his full-time Xfinity campaign, or so we thought. With sponsorship, team owner Matt Colleague and Nutrien Ag Solutions would pave way for Chastain to make the race. The RSS 38 was bought out, with Chastain replacing Jeff Green just hours before the start. From there were a lot of adjustments as they had to rewrap the car and put the 38 over it, and then they also had to adjust the car to Chastain's liking. In my opinion, this was one of the more just ride-bys in the garage. I mean, you look at it, Ross Chastain's competing for the championship, and Jeff Green, I mean, I hate to say it, but he's pretty much been riding around the last couple years. So it definitely made sense to put Ross Chastain in a ride, let him have all the maximum potential for his Xfinity championship, and then in the end, Ryan C. gets some extra money to develop its race team. Now, ironically, this wasn't the only time Ross Chastain bought his way into a race via a Ryan Sieg entry. Prior to the 2011 Ford 200, an 18-year-old Ross Chastain was hoping to make the race with sponsorship from National Watermelon Promotion Board. If you're wondering what the hell the National Watermelon Promotion Board is, on their website it states that the program's purpose is to maintain and expand existing markets and develop new markets for fresh watermelon. Nonetheless, they wanted to go truck racing with Ross Chastain. But because of the tropical Miami weather, time trials were completely washed out, and because the Donald Long number 20 had low owner's points, Ross Chastain would end up going home. Believe it or not, other drivers such as Tim George Jr., Brendan Newberry, and Frank Kimmel also failed to make the race, and they had some fairly solid sponsors as well. However, none of them would buy a ride into the race. Meanwhile, you had RSS Racing right there, three cars, none of which had sponsorship for the race. Therefore, the number 93 truck was bought out and Ross Chastain would get the race, the number 93 sponsored by the National Watermelon Board. Once again, it was a great way for the organization to get money and continue to climb up the ladder. Now, as for the race, it wasn't anything special. Ross Chastain would finish 27th, finishing two laps off of the pace set by winner Johnny Sauter. Nonetheless, the young 18-year-old got to race at the Homestead Miami Speedway and further build his craft for the near future. So anyways, this is NRF signing out, and just remember, life's a beach and then you drive.